preconceived notion or misconception, perhaps. But the comic books in today's world are not just for kids. They have a lot of great writers that have won awards and a wide range, so many titles. So I know a lot of you, and maybe you in particular, have been waiting for me to do a comic book video for a while, for like a year now, maybe more. So I apologize that I haven't done it sooner. The main reason is that I don't collect comic books anymore, or not, well, read. It's kind of the same thing, but there are some people that just collect. Investment, or potential investment. I don't collect anymore because primarily I don't have the time to read them. For me, it takes about 15-20 minutes to read a comic book. Number two, there's so many titles, there's hundreds of titles out there, and I could collect them all if I wanted to. I'm a very all-or-nothing type of person. And three, they are a little bit pricey. It's like $3, $2 to $3 a comic book. So that can add up. So it's a combination of those things. Now, I do want to get back into collecting just a couple titles. Like Hellboy, I don't know, maybe some others, I don't know, but we'll see. I don't want to make any promises. And of course, if you enjoy this particular video, let me know, and I will try to get around to making another one in some form or fashion. After this one or so. So, and welcome to this new second episode of The Joy of ASMR. This is really just to kind of, I want to, like I said, if you're new to this series, I want to create a very comfortable, traditional, I want to do traditional ASMR under the guise of this particular series, or under the title of this particular series. I want to kind of consolidate and kind of streamline things that I'm doing and things like that. So, and you can probably see I've got some action figures that were made available in like Target and Walmart. Toys R Us a couple years ago. And a couple other comic books here. Things like that. Just want to decorate it a little bit for you. Just to give it a nice comic book feel. Because this is all about comic books, if you haven't figured that out. Alright, so we're going to get started. And I'm going to start with two of the comics that got me into the world of comic books when I was a teenager. I met a great singularity of a human being. A guy moved into our school. Seventh or eighth grade, we became best friends. We split up after we graduated, and we lost touch, but he had a profound of Steel, which is a retelling or revamping of Superman. This is the one where he comes from Krypton, lands in the farm, and you know, they adopt him and all that, and he becomes Clark Kent. And this is what the movies were based off of, I believe. It's been a while since I read this, but I'll get to that. We'll look at this one. And the other one that I was looking at in the beginning of the video, the Justice League. This was great because this also had some comedic, there's some comedy in it. We have Guy Gardner, Green Lantern, smart ass, tough guy. He doesn't like rules. He doesn't like Batman, who was running the Justice League pretty much, and there was someone else over the Justice League who turned out to be not so nice. I think this is Black Canary. I can't remember. Martian Manhunter. Shazam, believe it or not. I never really liked that character. Dr. Fate, who I love. He uses magic. But not like... hard to explain. Mystic. Type magic. I've always loved this character, but just not, was never good enough for his own title or continuing title. I forget who she is. Blue Beetle. Starts with an M. Mr. Miracle or something like that. This was like has a great memory for me, a lot of nostalgia. I would love to hear from you in the comments. You know that I read the comments. I don't always get to your comments and respond to all of them. But those of you who actually take the time to write lengthy comments, and I do appreciate that. And I always try to respond to you in particular, but I always end up forgetting. So I'd love to hear from you some of your memories, how you got into the comic books. Do you remember the first comic book that you read? And things like that, your favorite ones that you read now, and of course any suggestions or recommendations for me to maybe pick up. I'll try. I can't promise anything. So that was a great one. Here is the Man of Steel that I was talking about, and this really captured my imagination. 6-part miniseries. And this was great because it's what I love about being ignorant, and I don't mean being willfully ignorant, mean person. I mean what I love about being ignorant about things that you don't really understand them, and then whether it's a philosophy or a culture or a musical genre, I love that moment when it's, you don't know about it, and then your mind becomes so absorbed and it's so brand new and it's awesome that moment. I love it. It's just eye-opening. It really is. And so those first comics that I collected, also Batman as well, and there was also Judge Dredd, because there was a run of Judge Dredd going on at the time, I think, unless it was over. I just remember searching through all the back issues, looking for all the Judge Dredd issues, so maybe the run wasn't going on at that time, I don't remember, but that was a great comic book. And then all the comic books that I did collect, there was another title that I loved called The Vigilante. I loved all the rule breakers. I collected them, put them in long boxes, and then we got rid of them because at that time I didn't understand fully about collecting, that we just stored them. I didn't think they were worth anything. It wasn't a big deal. I wanted to keep them for posterity, but it was like not a big deal. Okay, we just got rid of them or whatever. What a waste that was. Okay, so enough about my history. Let's keep going here. This is Severed, a little mini-series. I'm not really sure how many, but it's written by Scott Snyder, who is an amazing writer. You may have heard in my past comic book videos talk highly of him. I think he's definitely won some awards. It was supposed to be a horror series. I only collected the first one with the full intent. But I picked this up pretty much at the time when my interest in comics was waning. And just to give you an idea, he also, this was his only independent comic book at the time outside of DC. But there's American Vampire. I'm not sure if that's DC or not. Oh yeah, it's DC. So it tells a little bit about the creators behind this particular miniseries. Just some of the artwork, just real quick, because it's kind of copyrighted. Just can't show every single page and all that. So this looked like it had a lot of potential, and I should probably pick up the usually mini series. End up in paperback form, so there's probably a paperback trade paperback is what I meant. But if you've read this, I'd love to hear what you think, and if you haven't, you might want to pick it up because Scott's Right, and just like the shirt that I'm wearing, Conan, I'm not really sure the correct way to pronounce it, by Dark Horse Comics, independent. I don't think they're owned by Marvel or DC. Sometimes these independent, or sometimes these, I don't know what they're called, sister companies are owned, but this might be brings to life some of Robert E. Howard's stories, characters, and definitely the world, the mythos, and all that. Those of you not familiar with Conan, Robert E. Howard, he was back at the time of H.P. Lovecraft. They both corresponded with each other. And Robert E. Howard, he committed suicide, unfortunately. But he, his writing you can see the influence they had on each other. Robert E. Howard also had that high fantasy, I think you want to call it, but dark. And a lot of that elder god, strange creatures and things like that. So if you like H.P. Lovecraft, definitely check out some of the collected works of Robert E. Howard's Conan. And they did a great job with this series. See if I can... there's a good... There you go. There's a nice little swath of blood there. Artists and writers were behind the different runs of the Conan, but if you're a fan of Conan, Robert E. Howard's writings, it's great to see a comic book that keeps up with, or that keeps the characters going. So I definitely recommend checking these out. If they're on the shelves or picking up the trade paperback. And definitely check out the paperbacks of Robert E. Howard's Conan. Now this is another interesting little series that I found out about when it was already a dozen titles in or so. This is independent by Image. I think they're completely independent. I know, or they're by Marvel. I know. Don't think. Well, Image Comics has Robert Kirkman, the guy behind The Walking Dead, as the chief operating officer, and Todd McFarlane. McFarlane too. I did not know that Robert Kirkman was a COO. That's interesting. I think this is a completely independent company, not part of DC or Marvel, but I'm not an expert on all the comic book companies. I'm not sure if Robert Kirkman is still holds that title, but if you want an interesting and funny and off-the-wall read, pick this up. It's about a detective who works for the FDA in the United States, I think. And he has the ability to... he eats... let me see if there is a little... a blurb about this that I can explain it. Detective, and he has the it's eating what the person ate. I think he actually has to eat a piece of them. I was, they call it a particular word. It starts with a C, I think. I'm just looking here real quick. Let me see. Usually there's like a little blurb about the character. Okay. A cibopath or a cibopath. C-I-B-O-P-A-T-H. I'm trying to see if there's a scene in here where he eats. I'm just looking to see if there's a scene in here where he eats. Setting because it's just, this is the real deal. If you want a real vampire story, this is what it's all about, if you ask me. I believe it goes all throughout different time periods as well. Because vampires have been around for a very long time. And right there on that cover is one particular vampire who's a bit of a troublemaker. I just want to show you some of the artwork now. I wanted to continue collecting this. Stuff. I wish there was more artwork I could show you, but you can take a look online as well. Sometimes the titles are made available. You can download them digitally, so check that out. You can pay for them and then download them digitally. vampires. It doesn't hold back. I don't know if it's still going on. I hope that it is. I'm way far behind, though, for me to even get back into it. Maybe I would love to. Maybe if there's trade paperbacks, I'll pick them up. Is a very highly recommended comic book, Hellboy. This is simply a title you must collect, I feel. A lot of Lovecraft kind of vibe to it. I love the movies. The movies got me into this. I didn't really know too much about the comic, and just I was not collecting comic books for a good 2 decades or so. From like my late teens, 20s up to my, to my late 30s, early 40s, or early 40s actually. So like 20 years I didn't collect comics. Just imagine one particular series of trade paperbacks. I forget the name of it, but yeah.
It was a good...
it's a good series. And you may be able to find the trade paperbacks at your local library. Now, this is a spinoff of Hellboy. It's BPRD, Bureau of Paranormal Research and Development. Basically, you know, the whole Hellboy is supposed to become the Dark Lord himself, but he doesn't, so he fights evil. And then we have some other interesting characters. Hellboy is part of the BPRD, which has its own title. Hellboy is not usually in this one, so usually it's Abe, and then this ghost scientist. I'm not sure if there's any other new characters, and then there's the girl, I forget her name, she controls fire, and these are also little mini-series as well, for the most part. Sometimes tie into the main theme of Hellboy, and like I said, it's I'll show you one of these as well. Just it's pretty much the same artwork, but it not really. It can change based on the pencils. Ink. For instance, here's this particular one. You can see, hopefully, how the artwork is definitely not as blocky. It's a little different style. I like the BPRD because sometimes it ties in. It's often just as interesting as the Hellboy titles, or as Hellboy itself. See, there's a New World, 1 of 5. This is the Long Death. That's 1 of 3. And the Dead Remembered. That's 1 of 3 as well. So definitely worth. There's a huge, big volume Hellboy, which I paged through in one of my earlier ASMR videos. That's definitely worth having. It's a beautiful, beautiful book. The binding isn't the greatest. It tears away. The cover, thick cover, tears away from the glue. But it still stays intact as a book itself. Now, of course, The Walking Dead. Here's the first. This is the first issue that I picked up, 72, and it was not long after this when we found out that it would become a TV series, and the first issue just skyrocketed in price. I tried, I'll never forget, when I was back into comics at this time and collecting, which was a couple years ago, of course. I wanted to get the whole run from 1 to 71 because I fell in love with this title. And it was, the whole run was 70 titles. It was like $200 or $100. I don't know. It was not too expensive. But then once announcement of the TV series came out, it jumped up. It was just ridiculous. It was like $100 for the first issue. And it might even be more than that today. But this is the best zombie comic book I ever read. The story, Robert Kirkman's storytelling is impeccable. amazing. That's what this is all about. This is not about zombies eating people, and it's just, you know, that would get old. This is about the people, the characters, and he does not stay true to any of them. Any of them are expendable. So I don't know what issue it is up to now. It's gotta be 100. I'm not sure if it's 100, but or over 100. I don't know. 90s. It's once a month, so it's been about 3 years. I think it's up to 100 something by now. I know. But this is the trade paperback. Six books per trade paperback. And this is when there's Shane. Shane confronts Rick. Shane confronts Rick. I can't believe I almost forgot his name. And he's about to kill Rick. Shoots him right through the neck, and he kind of, I guess, chokes on his own blood and his jugular and all that. It's raw, it's emotional, it's brutal. There's a brutal scene involving Michonne. So if there's a comic book you want to check out and you like post-apocalyptic and you like zombies and you love characters and stories, this is a must-have. I collect the trade paperbacks, which the last one I have is like number 14 or 15. So I'm behind a few trade paperbacks, and I understand that there's a couple of main... I don't want to spoil anything. Well, I kind of already did, but anyway, I need to catch up on that. But I haven't just been able to find the time. So that's it for some of the lesser known, well, not necessarily lesser known, but some of the comic titles that are not as well known as titles by DC or Marvel. So we are going to DC and Marvel. Here's a Joker, just in case. I'm not sure if you can see that pretty well. These were pretty cool when it came out. I don't really collect. Let's see if I can get him to stand up now that I... Okay. Wow, that was magic. I don't really collect action figures that much, but when these hit the shelves, I really liked the company and how they created the design of these, and they're very poseable. They come with the little, the Joker has like a little deck of cards. He's got a fish, and I think he's got a cane. I don't know where they are, but yeah. All right, so get into Marvel, and I have here the Incredible Hulk. I've always loved the Hulk. This is by Jason Aaron. He also wrote for Wolverine. Great writer. And this is a new. This is back from 2014 or so. 2013. Yeah, 2013, 2014. I think 2013. I'll actually, instead of me sitting here and guessing, do we have here? When did this come out? 2011. Okay, I thought this was okay. I'm kind of in shock. I thought this. Oh, you know what this is. Okay, no, this is right. This is right, I think. If I understand, this is the relaunch of the new Hulk, where Banner, yeah. So, basically the Hulk became separated from Bruce Banner. His own entity. I don't remember how Bruce just kind of goes crazy, becomes obsessed with the gamma radiation and all this. I don't remember exactly, but this was a I don't remember the point of the series or the run. I'm not really sure if it's still going on, but I liked Jason Aaron as a writer. I love the pencils and the art design style. And it was just cool. It was a good way to get back into the Incredible Hulk. And I'll show you some of the artwork here. This is the Hulk. He has a son. I'm not really too keen on that, because there's actually like a Red Hulk, and the Hulk has his son, and there's all this, there's She-Hulk. I mean, I get it, what they're trying to expand the Hulk world universe and all this, but there's a Gray Hulk too. I think the Bruce Banner or the Hulk went to another world, and I forget how it happened. I think Bruce met a woman on this world and had offspring. That sounds kind of weird. Anyway, had children, and I forget how it all worked out. There was the War of Hulks and all this stuff, but that was an interesting little run. I just never kept it going for very long. Like I said, I got into it when my interest was starting to wane. And I just had, this became, you know, running this channel and doing these videos for you, and of course for me, it's a two-way street here, mutually beneficial thing we have going here. And so this is where my spare time is. This is my both a catharsis for me, a cathartic experience. It's a way for me to chill out, do something that I enjoy, be creative, and also give help, you know, give to you this very personal, relaxing, you know, beneficial thing that ASMR is. So my spare time was saying goodbye to this, and aside from family and, you know, all that, my time to this, to you. So, Silver Surfer, I've always loved the Silver Surfer. This is actually an old run. Let's see, when was this? 2003. This series is called Communion. And I've always loved the Silver Surfer. I know the idea of a surfboard, of a being, outer space, alien creature. Well, he's not really. He's a humanoid. He's not from Earth, another planet. And he become, I think Galactus goes to eat Silver Surfer's planet. And I forget what happens, but he makes him. Galactus Marcus makes Silver Surfer one of his heralds, and Silver Surfer's job is to go find new worlds for Galactus to devour, basically. And if I remember correctly, my history of Silver Surfer is correct, but I've always loved him because he does have a little bit of, he does have some heart, but he's, for the most part, he's not like this smiling, happy, he's not a Wolverine, he's not a Batman, he's just a very indifferent, and that's, he doesn't really care too much about anyone or anything too much, but he does get involved when he needs to. This one, it's almost has a pastel kind of airbrush look to it. So I tried to pick up Silver Surfer whenever I can. I've always had a fascination for this particular character, because I think I have an attraction to I don't want to say the underdogs, but Dr. Fate, the Silver Surfer, the Question. I'm while I do love myself, finding the bands, the obscure, that's what it is. I like the obscurity of some of these characters. It's kind of why I like comic books, because not everyone collects comic books. I don't know too many adults that collect the comic books besides those that we can find online. I'm talking in the real world. I have never come across hardly outside of a comic book shop or, you know, in an office setting, hardly anyone seems to collect the comics. But, I mean, you don't know what you're missing. It's great art and writing to be had, and a nice entertainment value. So, but I like the Silver Surfer. Always have. Daredevil. I'm not a huge fan of Daredevil. This is Shadowland, and this is the number one of the relaunching from back like 2012 or something like that. I'm gonna show you that one. I like the idea of the character. I like that he's blind. This is kind of a restart. Volume. Basically, every year or two, most all comic books, they'll go through a storyline, usually, for whatever reason, and they have 12 issues. They might run for 5,600 issues, but, so this was the first in a new volume, and I'm not really sure if this volume is still going on, but I try to get into it. I just... There doesn't seem to be anything too unique about them. Here you can see how they have tried to... Actually, let me get a better... how they try to visualize how he sees his environment using just, I guess, his mental perception or by hearing, wherever else. It's tries to stop him, and he actually goes away in hiding or something, and then they relaunch the series, if I understand correctly. I just don't know what it is about Daredevil that I'm just not a big fan of. I'm sure you are, and a lot of people are the same way. There's just you, certain art, a certain thing that you like, and you like it, you don't, kind of thing, but I don't know, it's just me. Alright, so this is one of the last. No, it's not. Okay. The Fantastic Four. This is by a writer named Hickman. It was. I'm not sure if he's still writing. Misconception you might have about the stretchy guy and the big clumsy oaf of the rock guy and the fire guy and the invisible woman. They've kind of, they still have those powers, but it's not as hokey and corny as you might remember from old cartoons or bad movies. This up, there was a great run going on, and it ended with Firestorm, something happening to him. I won't ruin it, but it's definitely worth checking out this run. It's 587 and 588. I'm not sure what that might mean in paperback. Sometimes the paperbacks have a certain title. There's some artwork in here. Here's a nice scene here of Galactus. Spider-Man. Spider-Man. I think there's a bunch of different people involved of Spider-Man's, what's the word? Spider-Man's menagerie of villains, I guess. This was a great run. I like this one, the Grim Hunt. Of course, that's Spidey. And then the Fantastic Four symbol going up due to the Fantastic Four, related to the Fantastic Four titles I just showed you. But I kind of stopped collecting Spider-Man because he started to get a little more gadget-oriented. He got a job at some high-tech facility and started making different suits, and Marvel was trying to, I don't know what they were trying to do with Spider-Man, but, so I don't know if that all, if all of that high-tech stuff is going on still. It kind of turned me off a little bit. I don't like all the gadget stuff with my superheroes. I know it's kind of odd. I just like, you know, I like, Batman is an exception, but he doesn't really, Batman doesn't really rely on a ton of gadgets anymore, like he used to, whatever. I kind of like the superheroes or, you know, just like Wolverine, you know, just Spider-Man just shooting his webs. Simple. I like the simple. Not all this gadgetry and stuff, you know, and vehicles, just, you know, because you're a superhero, you don't need gadgets and you don't need vehicles and all that. So that just, to me, it's just a logical kind of thing, even though it's fantasy and make-believe. But hey, that's me. So, all right, we are going to finish up Marvel. Yeah, here you go. Here's they call it the FF. I'm not sure if it's still called that or not, but you can see their outfits. Pretty cool. Fantastic Four these days, but Doctor Doom is one of their arch nemesis, and I love Doctor Doom. He's got some mystic abilities, you know, magic, but I like to say mystic. He's a mystic, I guess you would call him. And oh, look at that, there's a game out, or may still be out, called Rift. There's an advertisement, so just anyway. Yeah, so here's some of the artwork. So yeah, that was an enjoyable run by Jonathan Hickman. So if you get a chance to check out those issues or trade paperbacks, look for Hickman. And then we have Captain America, and this is actually the death of Captain America. He gets shot and killed. And I forget how they bring him back to life. If you remember, originally Captain America was tied to a rocket or something like that. No, it was it Bucky? I don't remember. And Captain America ended up in the ice or out in the Arctic or something, frozen. some don't. Captain America did not agree with it, I believe. Iron Man went along with it, and I believe, and they went, they had a little mini war, and I think Captain America was shot and killed by those because he was going against the government. So that was interesting, yeah. There's right here. I don't think yet. Yeah, he gets shot right here by a SHIELD agent because SHIELD ends up working for the government, controlled by the government. He gets shot. That's actually the final. And then she can't believe what she did. And there he is there in the morgue. He actually gets shot before that. See if I can, if they have that scene in here. He's going to the courthouse or something. I guess to stand trial for treason or something like that. I can't remember. Surrenders, basically. So he's giving a conference at the steps of City Hall or somewhere. And then he notices on the back of a police marshal red dot, there's a sniper up in a window. He's like, look out, and he gets shot. Shots, blam, 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 he gets shot again, I think. There he is on the steps. And then at the end, I don't remember if this is a memory of what happens, but you can see it's, he gets shot originally. She comes over to help him, but actually she's the one who shoots him again. I think she was mind controlled, if I remember correctly. So, I think this might have made the news. I don't recall, but I love the cover. It's, and this was by, Captain America with that volume starting like with in the rest of these. This is all going to be DC, but I'm going to show you some cool titles. This is The Secret Six, which had about 30, 40 titles by a female writer, Gail Simone. Great writer. She also wrote Wonder Woman. I don't know what else, but The Secret Six. I definitely look into this by Gail Simone. Look for the trade paperbacks, I guess. I just love this cover. This is a great cover. This is Wonder Woman number 606. I don't know what's so special about this one, but I think this was relaunched, and with DC, the New 52, and Gail Simone, I think, was writing. I don't remember. I think. Was it that Straczynski guy? The Wonder Woman volume or run before the New 52, definitely worth checking out. She gets into a war with everyone from her own planet. Very, very cool. A lot of mythology type stuff and things like that, from what I remember. This is Batman Beyond. This is really cool. This is Batman of the future. He's a young adult, and he's actually this is kind of taped up and sealed. I don't really go through that, but Bruce Wayne is older and retired, and he trains a new kid to be Batman. It's pretty neat. This. Some of his stuff gets a little convoluted and whatever, but this particular run was great. This is Damian Wayne, Bruce's son. He son of him and Ra's al Ghul's daughter, or forget her name, but he's a little bit of a mean streak in him. I don't know what's still going this title or with Damien, but love this run. This was great. 2009, actually, but I wasn't collecting, so I might have gone back and picked this run up. You can actually go out on eBay and people will actually sell a complete run, and what I mean by that is, like, particular title might have 12 issues, it might have 50. It's usually called a volume, 1 to 50, and that's also called a run. And you might be able to get all 50, and you might be able to get a decent price on eBay if you want the actual issues. Birds of Prey by Gail Simone. This was a good run. I enjoyed that. Was that the New 52? I don't remember. I don't think so. That was 2010. I think the New 52 was 2012, 2013, yeah. Of course, we have Batman, A Death in the Family. This is where... This is the end of an era, pretty much, when the little happy Batman and Robin duo things... It leads up to Batman Year One by Frank Miller, and where revisits or retells the story of Batman and how his parents got killed, and becomes more dark and gritty, like the Dark Knight that we know today. This was, they killed Robin in it. Out in the Middle East, I think, in a desert, something like this, and gets a hold of Robin, traps Robin, and those standards. And they tie Robin up. And there's a bomb. There's another woman there. I don't know if she gets free. She gets free. Counting down the seconds here. Francis Manipal did the pencils for how the flash moves. And they made it very... Pencil lines and whatever, I don't even remember, but it was not like this.